Harper Audio presents Altar of Eden by James Rollins, performed by Paula Christensen. Copyright 2010 by James Tchaikovsky. Production copyright 2010 by HarperCollins Publishers. And Babylon shall become heaps, a dwelling place for dragons, an astonishment, and a hissing, without an inhabitant. Jeremiah chapter 51, verse 37. And what rough beast, its hour come round at last, slouches toward Bethlehem to be born. W.B. Yeats. The study of nature makes a man at last as remorseless as nature. H.G. Wells. April 2003, Baghdad, Iraq. The two boys stood outside the lion's cage.
I don't want to go inside, the smaller one said.
He kept close to his older brother and clasped tightly to his hand. The two were bundled in jackets too large for their small forms, faces swathed in scarves, heads warmed by woolen caps. At this early hour, with the sun not yet up, the pre-dawn chill had crept down to their bones. They had to keep moving.
Buddy, the cage is empty. Stop being a Shakif. Look.
McKeem, the older of the two, pushed the black iron gate wider and revealed the bare concrete walls inside. A few old gnawed bones lay piled in a dark corner. They would make a nice soup. McKeen stared out at the ruins of the zoo. He remembered how it had once looked. Half a year ago, for his 12th birthday, they had come here to picnic at the Al Zahra Gardens with its amusement park rides and zoo. The family had spent a long, warm afternoon wandering among the cages of monkeys, parrots, camels, wolves, bears. McKeen had even fed one of the camels an apple. He still remembered the rubbery lips on his palm. Standing here now, he stared across the same park with older eyes, far older than half a year ago. The park sprawled outward in a ruin of rubble and refuse. It was a haunted wasteland of fire-blackened walls, fetid pools of oily water, and blasted buildings. A month ago, McKeen had watched from their apartment near the park as a firefight blazed across the lush gardens, waged by American forces and the Republican Guard. The fierce battle had begun at dusk, with a rattle of gunfire and the shriek of rockets continuing throughout the night. But by the next morning, all had gone quiet. Smoke hung thickly and hid the sun for the entire day. From the balcony of their small apartment, McKeen had spotted a lion as it loped out of the park and into the city. It moved like a dusky shadow, then vanished into the streets. Other animals also escaped, but over the next 2 days, hordes of people had swarmed back into the park. Looters, his father had named them, and spat on the floor, cursing them in more foul language. Cages were ripped open. Animals were stolen, some for food, some to be sold at the black market across the river. McKean's father had gone with a few other men to get help to protect their section of the city from the roving bands. He had never returned. None of them had. Over the next weeks, the burden had fallen upon McKeen to keep his family fed. His mother had taken to her bed, her forehead burning with fever, lost somewhere between terror and grief. All McKeen could get her to do was drink a few sips of water. If he could make a nice soup for her, get her to eat something more. He eyed the bones in the cage again. Each morning, he and his brother spent the hour before dawn searching the bombed-out park and zoo for anything they could scrounge to eat. He carried a burlap sack over his shoulder. All it held was a moldy orange and a handful of cracked seed swept up off the floor of a birdcage. Little Bari had also found a dented can of beans in a rubbish bin. The discovery had brought tears to McKean's eyes. He kept the treasure rolled up inside his little brother's thick sweater. Yesterday, a larger boy with a long knife had stolen his sack, leaving McKean empty-handed when he returned. They'd had nothing to eat that day. But today, they would eat well. Even Mother, inshallah, he prayed. McKean entered the cage and dragged Bari with him. Distant gunfire crackled in short spurts, like the scolding claps of angry hands trying to warn them off. McKean took heed. He knew they had to hurry. He didn't want to be out when the sun was up. It would grow too dangerous. He hurried to the pile of bones, dropped his sack, and began shoving the gnawed knuckles and broken shafts inside. Once finished, he tugged the sack closed and stood. Before he could take a step, a voice called in Arabic from nearby. Yalla! This way! Over here! McKean ducked and pulled Bari down with him. They hid behind the knee-high cinder block wall that fronted the lion's cage. He hugged his brother, urging him to remain silent as two large shadows passed in front of the lion's cage. Risking a peek, McKean caught a glimpse of two men. One was tall in a khaki military uniform. The other was squat with a round belly dressed in a dark suit. The entrance is hidden behind the zoo clinic, the fat man said as he passed the cage. He huffed and wheezed to keep up with the longer strides of the man in military fatigues. I can only pray we are not too late. McKean spotted the holstered pistol on the taller man's belt and knew it would be death to be found eavesdropping. Bari shivered in his embrace, sensing the danger too. Unfortunately, the men did not go far. The clinic was directly across from their hiding spot. The fat man ignored the twisted main door. Days ago, crowbars had forced the way open. The facility had been cleaned out of drugs and medical supplies. Instead, the heavy figure stepped to a blank wall framed by two columns. McKean could not make out what the man did as he slipped his hand behind one of the columns, but a moment later, a section of the wall swung open. It was a secret door. McKean shifted closer to the bars. Father had read them stories of Ali Baba, tales of secret caverns and vast stolen treasures hidden in the desert. All he and his brother had found at the zoo were bones and beans. McKean's stomach churned as he imagined a feast fit for the prince of thieves that might wait below. Stay here, the fat man said, ducking through the entrance and down a dark set of stairs. The military man took up a post by the doorway. His palm rested on his pistol. His gaze swung toward their hiding spot. McKean ducked out of sight and held his breath. His heart pounded against his ribs. Had he been spotted? Footsteps approached the cage. McKean clung tightly to his brother. But a moment later, he heard a match strike and smelled cigarette smoke. The man paced the front of the cage as if he were the one behind the bars, stalking back and forth like a bored tiger. Bari shook within McKean's embrace. His brother's fingers were clamped hard in his. What if the man should wander into the cage and find them huddled there? It seemed an eternity when a familiar wheezing voice echoed out of the doorway. I have them. The cigarette was dropped and ground out onto the cement just outside the cage door. The military man crossed back to join his companion. The fat man gasped as he spoke. He must have run all the way back up. The incubators were offline, he said. I don't know how long the generators lasted after the power went out. McKean risked a peek through the bars of the cage door. The fat man carried a large metal briefcase in his hand. Are they secure? The military man asked. He also spoke in Arabic, but his accent was not Iraqi. The fat man dropped to one knee, balanced the case on his thick thigh, and thumbed open the lock. McKean expected gold and diamonds. But instead, the case held nothing but white eggs packed in molded black foam. They appeared no different from the chicken eggs his mother bought at the market. Despite his terror, the sight of the eggs stirred McKean's hunger. The fat man counted them, inspecting them. They're all intact, he said, and let out a long, rattling sigh of relief. God willing, the embryos inside are still viable. And the rest of the lab? The fat man closed the case and stood up.
I'll leave it to your team to incinerate what lies below. No one must ever suspect what we've discovered. There can be no trace. I know my orders.
As the fat man stood, the military man raised his pistol and shot his companion in the face. The blast was a thunderclap. The back of the man's skull blew away in a cloud of bone and blood. The dead man stood for a moment longer, then flopped to the ground. McKean covered his mouth to stifle any sound. No trace, the murderer repeated, and collected the case from the ground. He touched a radio on his shoulder. He switched to English.
Bring in the trucks and prime the incendiary charges. Time to get out of this sandbox before any locals turn up.
McKean had learned to speak a smattering of the American language. He couldn't pick out every word the man spoke, but he understood the message well enough. More men were coming. More guns. McKean sought some means of escape, but they were trapped in the lion's cage. Perhaps his younger brother also recognized the growing danger. Bari's shaking had grown worse since the gunshot. Finally, his little brother's terror could no longer be held inside, and a quiet sob rattled out of his thin form. McKean squeezed his brother and prayed that the cry had not been heard. Footsteps again approached. A sharp call barked toward them in Arabic.
Who's there? Show yourself.
Ta'al hna.
McKean pressed his lips to his brother's ear.
Stay hidden. Don't come out.
McKean shoved Bari tighter into the corner, then stood up with his hands in the air. He backed a step.
I was just looking for food, McKean said,
stuttering, speaking fast. The pistol stayed leveled at him.
Get out here, Walad.
McKean obeyed. He moved to the cage door and slipped out. He kept his hands in the air.
Please, Aki, la termi.
He tried switching to English to show he was on the man's side.
No, shoot. I not see. I not know.
He fought to find some argument, some words to save him. He read the expression on the other man's face, a mixture of sorrow and regret. The pistol lifted higher with merciless intent. McKean felt hot tears flow down his cheeks. Through the blur of his vision, he noted a shift of shadows. Behind the man, the secret door cracked open wider, pushed from inside. A large, dark shape slipped out and flowed toward the man's back. It ran low and stuck to the deeper shadows as if fearing the light. McKean caught the barest glimpse of its oily form. Muscular, lean, hairless, with eyes glinting with fury. His mind struggled to comprehend what he was seeing, but failed. A scream of horror built inside his chest. Though the beast made no noise, the man must have felt a prickling of warning. He swung around as the creature leaped with a sharp cry. Gunshots blasted, eclipsed by a savage wail that raised the hairs on McKean's body. McKean swung away and rushed back to the cage.
Body!
He grabbed his brother's arm and dragged him out of the lion's cage. He pushed Bari ahead of him.
Yalla, run!
Off to the side, man and beast fought on the ground. More pistol shots fired. McKean heard the heavy tread of boots on pavement behind him. More men came running from the other side of the park. Shouts were punctuated by rifle blasts. Ignoring them all, McKean fled in raw terror across the bombed-out gardens, careless of who might see him. He kept running and running, chased by screams that would forever haunt his nightmares. He understood nothing about what had happened. He knew only one thing for certain. He remembered the beast's ravenous eyes, shining with a cunning intelligence, aglow with a smokeless fire. McKean knew what he had seen. The beast, known as Shaitan in the Quran, he who was born of God's fire and cursed for not bowing down to Adam. McKean knew the truth. At long last, the devil had come to Baghdad. Act 1. First Blood. Chapter 1.
May 23rd, 7:32 a.m.
New Orleans.
The Bronco crushed through the debris left by the hurricane and bounced off yet another hole. Lorna nearly hit the roof of the cabin. The car slid to the left on the wet road. She eased off the accelerator as she fought for control. The storm had stripped vegetation, sent creeks overflowing their banks, and even floated an alligator into someone's swimming pool. Luckily, the worst of the dying hurricane had struck farther west. Still, with such downpours, Mother Nature seemed determined to turn Orleans Parish back into swamplands. As Lorna sped along the river road, all she could think about was the phone call. It had come in 20 minutes ago. They'd lost power at Acres. The generators hadn't kicked in and 100 research projects were threatened. As she rounded a final oxbow in the Mississippi River, the compound appeared ahead. The Audubon Center for Research.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.